A data analyst works with various data formats. One of the formats that a data analyst will probably encounter most is data stored in a database. So, it is extremely important that you understand the basic foundations of databases. In the first topic of this lesson, you will learn how to identify relational databases, and then you will learn how to identify non-relational databases.
Hey there! If we haven't met yet, I'm Lieutenant Commander Data, your favorite data nerd and the galaxy's favorite teacher in anything involving data. I'm the host of the LC Data Channel, and I will break down some data concepts and show you tips and tricks behind the most popular data analysis and reporting tools. In my world, and yours, I've been a certified trainer in various data platforms and disciplines for the past 2.5 decades, and I train thousands of Earthlings working in many different industries. Humans just like you. Oh, and all of the websites and resources I mentioned in my videos are linked in the description box below. I also posted how and where you can download all the project files I use in my demonstrations. If you are a big fan of data in general, then we have something in common. So go and smash that subscribe button and hit the notifications bell so that Scotty can notify you every time I have an important transmission to share with you.
Now, buckle up and get ready to lift off, Earthlings. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. One of the first things you must learn if you want to become a data analyst is to identify the type of database you're working with, because that can dictate your decision-making as a data analyst. The major types of databases that you may encounter in your career are relational databases and non-relational databases. It is crucial that you have a solid understanding of what differentiates relational from non-relational databases. As a data analyst, it is not really important for you to know how to create a database, but you must understand how the tables in a relational database are designed and how the fields interact with each other. This will help you build necessary sets for your own analysis projects. And that is exactly what we will focus on in this lesson. Before we start, I will use Microsoft SQL Server to demonstrate the concepts of relational databases and data warehouses. I will also use Microsoft Power BI in future lessons when we cover data analysis and reporting. If you want to mimic what I'm doing, you must install the software on your computer. As I mentioned, as a data analyst, you are usually tasked with working with databases, but it is not a data analyst's job to create them. But we do need to spend a little time to understand the design theory of a database. This will help you to understand and interpret the structural design of databases. Let's look at the key characteristics of the two main types of databases, namely relational databases and non-relational databases. We will start with relational databases. If you are already a data analyst, then you will likely have been exposed to relational databases and relational database management systems, like Microsoft SQL Server, Microsoft Access, Oracle, and any other vendor-specific software that's used for storing and managing data. But if you haven't, I'll quickly walk you through the basics. A relational database uses containers called tables to store data that is captured. You might also note that this type of format is often referred to as a tabular schema. Software that maintains relational databases is often referred to as a relational database management system, or an RDBMS in short. The copy of SQL Server you downloaded and installed is an example of a relational database management system. Tables are created with fields or columns, which is also often called field names, and each row is a record of data that represents an entity or data of that table. If you wanted to create a table of all the customers for a business, you would create field names like customer number or customer ID, first name, last name, and any other attributes that describe a customer. Then, you would list on each row the person's customer ID, first name, last name, and other values under the designated field names. Tables in a relational database have two main design components, the field name and the data type. We will explore these two components deeper in a later lesson. This design of a relational database is drawn by a database architect. Database architects are those guys in your company that often spend a great amount of time planning and designing a relational database. Like an architect in the construction industry, a database architect draws a blueprint of the database structure. This drawing is called an entity relationship diagram, or an ERD in short. The shaping of this plan is done in various steps using a design technique called normalization. Normalization ensures that your database is using storage optimally. We will dive into normalization in the next lesson. Architects must determine what data needs to be stored and how to relate the tables of data to each other through relationships. A good practice is to have one or more fields in your table that uniquely identifies each record. For example, each customer in your customer's table will have a field that makes a customer record unique, like customer ID or customer key. And an orders table will have an order ID or an order number that makes each record unique. This unique field is called the primary key of your table. And because it ensures that every record is a unique entity, we say that it enforces entity integrity. So if you attempt to capture two records with the same value in the primary key field, your table will not allow it because the primary key is a constraint that a database developer applies to the field to maintain the integrity of the data. A table also may have a relationship with another table. Maybe it's different in your world, but in my world, I have a relationship with my son and daughter. Just like in your world, I can have many children, but my children can only have one father. We don't have things like father-in-laws in my world.
While another more liberal attitude would allow the child enormous freedom,
Data.
And what Klingons do to their children.
Data, I am not talking about parenting. I am talking about the extraordinary consequences of creating a new life.
Does that not describe becoming a parent, sir?
So, in a database, I will be in a table called Fathers, and I will have a father ID as my primary key. My two kids will not be stored in the same table as I, because they are not fathers. They must be stored in a table called Children, and each one will have a unique child ID. I will also not be the only father in the Fathers table, and my kids will not be the only kids in the Children table. If we are stored in separate tables, there must be a way to determine who are my children and who are the other father's children. We do that by creating a relationship between the two tables. Relationships are established between two tables on fields with common values. For example, the children table has a relationship with the father table because I raised them and they depended on me. We call this relationship a one-to-many relationship because a father can raise many children, but a child can have only one father. Like I mentioned, we must somehow determine who are my children and who are the other father's children. To know which children are mine, children must have something that matches them to a related father. That something is a special field called a foreign key field. A foreign key field will relate to the primary key field of another table. For example, the children table will also have a father ID, the primary key field of the father's table, which is also called father ID. If a child in the children table matches the father ID in the father's table, we know which children were raised by a specific father. The many side of a one-to-many relationship is the related table and will always have a foreign key that references a primary key on the one side of the one-to-many relationship. Like primary keys, foreign keys are there to enforce data integrity. In other words, to protect the database from invalid inputs. But we will delve deeper into data integrity and constraints in a later lesson. After the architect designed the structure of the database, the result will be a diagram that looks like this. This is the ERD, or an entity relationship diagram, I talked about earlier. And the type of structure depicted by an ERD is called a relational model. When you are using a relational database, you need to be able to retrieve the data stored in the tables and across tables. You can do that with a language called Structured Query Language. Structured Query Language, or SQL, is the language used to query and manage data in a relational database. SQL is a standardized programming language used by different vendors to query data with vendor-specific software like Microsoft SQL Server or Oracle. We use the acronym SQL for the language called Structured Query Language, but you will often hear we refer to software that uses the language as SQL, for example, Microsoft SQL Server. Just like English US and English UK, there are also different forms or dialects of SQL. For example, when using Microsoft SQL Server, you will use Transact SQL, or T-SQL in short, which has additional coding elements that are specific to Microsoft's software. When data is retrieved from relational databases, there is usually some version of SQL involved in the process, whether you are coding it directly through SQL statements or using a wizard or designer that does the coding in the background for you. And that is how relational databases work in a nutshell. Now, let's talk about non-relational databases. A non-relational database, often referred to as a NoSQL database, is any alternative to a relational SQL database. They are called NoSQL databases because they don't use structured query language when retrieving data. This type of database addresses the need for web-based databases to handle large amounts of traffic and a variety of data. They are easier to scale for the smallest web applications to the largest e-commerce or social media sites like Amazon.com, YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. You will often hear data professionals talk about big data. A database that hosts big data is a NoSQL database. Consider an example of a social media website like Facebook. You can upload videos, photos, audios, and text to Facebook. These multimedia projects are stored in an unstructured way because files for multimedia are different than simple dates, numbers, and text values that fit neatly into columns. So a non-relational database does not use the same tabular schema with rows and columns that you find in a relational database. Whereas a relational database contains tables with defined relationships, non-relational databases store their data in several different ways depending on the type of data required by a specific development. A non-relational database is more flexible than a relational database, and it is ideal for data that doesn't fit into the more rigid structure of a relational database. The way we retrieve data from a non-relational database also differs from the way we do this for relational databases. While relational databases require traditional SQL-based queries, you will often use different programming languages to retrieve the data you need from a non-relational database. There are four basic categories in NoSQL databases we will explore. Document-oriented databases store data in XML documents, or JSON files. They are flexible in that they allow developers to reshape the data to meet the format needed for the application. XML is short for Extensible Markup Language, and JSON is short for JavaScript Object Notation. Both these languages are web standards maintained by a group called the World Wide Web Consortium, or the W3C. I will dive deeper into XML and JSON. Key value stores store each value with a key and a value. This is the same as a table with just two columns, a field or key, and a value. Column-oriented database store data in columns rather than rows. This design can make for easier analysis in some cases where aggregation or number crunching is needed, such as when counting, summing, or averaging the total number of orders. We also refer to this structure as column stores. Graph stores store individual elements as nodes. This type of database is more complex and focuses on the relationships between data elements. In a graph database, the connections are first-class elements of the database and stored directly. You will often find that graph databases run side-by-side with a relational database. And that is non-relational databases in a nutshell. Okay, Earthling, that's enough for now. I will leave you now to process the information I shared with you today in your own time. Remember to subscribe and, while you're there, give me a thumbs up. Thank you for watching. I'll see you soon with another insightful transmission. From me, Lieutenant Commander Data, live long and prosper, Earthling.
Say goodbye, Data.
Goodbye, Data.